that they're talking about is very scary.
Yeah, it is. It's and it's going to control us. It actually.
That, no, it's controlling your life already. Already you have no clue. Yeah.
Into a world which is.
I'm saying today you look at this, every corner of the universe, your life.
Yeah.
Universe.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Good to go. I can't see myself. Hi, this is Anuranjan, and this is episode 5 of Real to Real. And today, I'm sorry we started 5 minutes late because there was terrible traffic in Bombay. But now here we go. My guest here is an Indo-German creation, a British-born actress, known to some as wife of one of Bollywood's top film directors, mother of 2 daughters, and known to many as the mother of one of India's most talented favorite film stars, but known to me as one of the finest actresses herself, a beautiful human being inside and out, and a joyful soul to be around. Please welcome Soni Razdan.
Thank you so much, Anu.
You're welcome.
So sweet.
No, welcome, Soni. Now, Soni, we're going to do a few questions and answers and things about you which mostly people, some they know, some they don't know.
Okay.
Okay, so we get started. Now, sure. I want to first know about your early days, how your parents met and your siblings, because they are both from 2 different parts of the world, right? Okay, your mother's a German, your father's a Kashmiri. So I just want to know how they met and how it came to be.
Well, they actually met in my favorite city, that is London. Mom had come from Germany as a political refugee. That's another story altogether. We'll have to have a separate chat for that. But yeah, so she had come for this. She had come when she was a child, actually, to the UK. They got asylum in the UK. And so she kind of grew up there from the age of about 8 or 10 years old onwards.
Okay.
And my dad was studying to be an architect.
Oh.
But he took 9 years to study architecture because, you see, this performer thing runs in the family. Because while he was studying to be an architect, he was very good at playing the violin.
Okay.
He joined a very famous dancer called Ram Gopal in those days.
In London?
In London, yeah. He was, well, okay. Ram Gopal was, I think, yeah, he was an Indian guy. He had a troupe. Zora Segal's sister, you know, the very famous actress, Zora, her sister, Uzra. And there were a whole lot of them. They were all in part of that troupe of his. And he used to travel all over the world. So while Dad was studying to be an architect, he was also performing in this group.
So as it runs in the family, sort of.
Seems to. Yeah, okay. Definitely okay. Music does.
Okay.
And yeah. So he was. So he was having this performance in London, and he had given a ticket to one of his. Friends who happened to be a girl. I don't know if it was a serious girlfriend or anything. It was just a girl. And she happened to know my mom. And she couldn't go for the show. So she gave the ticket to my mother.
Oh, God.
And she said, you go. And after the show, please go backstage and thank Mr. Razdan for the ticket.
Okay.
So she went backstage after the show. And I'm sure she'd never seen anything like that Ram Gopal show and that music and everything before in her life because she was completely Western, you know.
Right.
And she was working as a teacher for small children, nursery school teacher in London.
Okay.
And she went to thank, and my dad saw from a distance and he told his friend, he said, there were 2 girls. She took a friend with her. He said, the one in the red duffel coat is mine. You keep quiet. And then he went and they said, hi, and he said, will you like to come out for coffee?
And that's how it started.
And that's how it started.
Oh, God. Yeah. So,
as a result, I was born in the UK.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
See, because we heard that your mom was a survivor of the Holocaust.
Yes, yes.
She came from what we know as Nazi Germany.
But she wasn't Jewish.
But
she wasn't was
Jewish.
German. Yeah.
Okay, Nazi
so
Germany.
So that's a big story.
Okay, and then her family was thrown out before ending up as refugees, right?
They were not thrown out. They escaped from Germany because her father was arrested.
Tell us about that.
You want to know?
Yeah, seriously,
to
know.
Okay, so basically, of course, she was very small. My grandfather was a German, but he was very much against Hitler. And Hitler hadn't really come, he was coming into power or had come into power in those years. He was running an underground newspaper, my grandfather, against Hitler.
Okay.
It was a secret newspaper.
Oh God. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So finally, obviously, and this was before the war. This was about 2 years before the war or 2.5 years before the war.
Okay.
He was obviously found out and he was arrested. But I think because they didn't have enough evidence against him, they couldn't kill him. I mean, it begs the question that why did they need evidence to kill? Because in those days, they didn't need much evidence to kill anybody. Yeah, they used to kill everybody and anybody who they thought was a threat. But for some reason, I think my grandmother, she was working for a legal company. So he had a very good lawyer.
Okay.
So that guy saved his life, basically. My mother and my grandmother, my mom was 6 years old.
She's the only child.
She's the only child in those days. Yeah, okay. Were not able to have another child under the circumstances.
Right.
So they literally left their house behind in Berlin. They lived in Berlin, in East Berlin, that too. In those days, it was not East Berlin. It was all one Berlin.
Right.
They left it and they took a train to Czechoslovakia just before the border. They got off the train with their suitcases. That's all they have. They left everything behind. And they said they're going for a family wedding to Czechoslovakia. And actually, I mean, luckily my grandmother had a brother living in Czechoslovakia.
So they were.
So she said, yeah, so he came to meet them. So they walked across the border with nothing.
My God.
And they went to Czechoslovakia.
Oh God,
And they lived there for 2 years. My mother and her and my grandmother. My grandfather was in a concentration camp by this time.
They hadn't released him.
No, he was in a concentration camp. He was not released at all.
Oh God.
He was in jail, in a camp, where he saw everything. I mean, he witnessed everything, and he also was treated really badly there. So it affected the rest of his life, actually, in terms of his health and everything.
But they met eventually?
So basically, mommy and my grandmother went across the border. They lived in Czechoslovakia for 2 years. Mommy went to school there. She was 6. She became 8. In those 2 years, she learned how to speak Czechoslovakian. Czech. And then the war broke out and the Nazis invaded Czechoslovakia. And my grandmother always, she used to narrate the story to me. And every time she used to narrate it, my hair used to stand up on end and I used to get tears in my eyes. She said, the people of that place where they were staying, Prague probably, they lined the streets, the civilians just lined the streets. And the Nazis were goose-stepping into the city and there was pin drop silence. And people were just weeping. Quietly.
Anyway,
they came then. The whole story starts here, actually, because my mother and grandmother were then under you know, they were escapees.
Right.
So they had to leave Czechoslovakia. Otherwise, they would have been found out. They would have taken the papers and they would have said, like, you know, what are you doing here?
Okay.
And all that. You went for a wedding and you're still staying here. Whatever.
Okay.
So they literally had to escape from Czechoslovakia. So 2 weeks down the line, they escaped. On a train, there was a very good organization called the Quaker Organization, which I think still exists today.
Okay.
Where they used to help people escape, like from Germany, from Czechoslovakia, from all these places where they are just an organization which did all this good. They were there was a Jewish train full of Jewish children, where they were taking out the kids out of there. So the parents were stuck, but the kids they were allowed to leave.
Okay.
So they were taking them to England. England used to take these people as political refugees in those days. So mommy and my grandmother escaped on that train.
Oh my God.
And that's how they landed up in England.
And then
my grandfather was released because he was not killed, so he was allowed to leave or whatever. And he was sent to the Isle of Man in the UK.
Yeah.
And then he was like there for some time in quarantine and then they were finally reunited.
But you knew where they were and
all those organizations were helping them. And then finally they were reunited.
So this was from Birmingham to Bombay.
Birmingham to Bombay.
I mean, where in England did you all live? In London itself?
No, they lived somewhere else. I don't know where. They were reunited and then.
And
they
were born where?
In Birmingham.
That's what I'm saying. From Birmingham to Bombay is your story.
It is
there.
My story. Yeah.
Tell us.
I was born in Birmingham.
You were born in Birmingham and you have a sibling, you have a sister.
Yeah, but she was born in Bombay.
Oh, that was when your parents had come. So how did they come? Because your dad was from India. So he wanted to come back to Bombay.
He was an architect. Then he qualified.
Then he married your mom. He said, this is
the
woman I want.
He qualified, he started working. They courted for some reasonable amount of time. And he came from a good Kashmiri family. So, they were all looking for a Kashmiri bride for him. And I believe so he wrote to my grandfather saying, I found the girl I want to marry and all. And it happens to be so and so. He said, oh no, we found a very nice Kashmiri girl for you. It's Kashmiri redhead or something like that. My dad always tells us this story. And my father said, no, I don't want any Kashmiri redhead. I want to marry
my blonde German girl.
Yes. So then I believe they wrote back and said, what cannot be cured must be endured. So that's how they got married. And then I was born. And then he said, I'm an architect. And he felt at that time that perhaps in the UK he would always be maybe a second class citizen or whatever.
Okay.
And India was just, you know, had just gained independence. There were lots of buildings being built.
Right.
So he said, I want to go there and start my life. And so they came to Bombay.
Wow. Wow. Okay, Sonia, now see, German Christian, Kashmiri Hindu. And now you embrace Islam for marriage, am I right?
Actually, I don't know how to say this. I don't think I embraced, because I have to say that as a person, I'm not a very religious person.
Okay.
So for me, whatever religion I am or I'm supposed to be, it actually doesn't matter. Because to be religion is not what defines me.
Okay.
What defines me is me. Without religion.
So you basically didn't relate to any of them. It just happened.
Yes. It's just a question
by
of...
By default. One is by birth and one is by marriage.
And Mahesh happened to be a half Muslim.
Right.
So that was an avenue that we could at that point, I'm sorry to say, but that was the avenue that, you know, gave us this ability to actually live together as husband and wife.
Right.
Otherwise, and in those days, it was very difficult to live together without being married.
So tell me, then you come to Bombay, at that time you were not married. You were into theater, film, television.
No, I came to Bombay when I was 3 months old.
Ah, okay. So you were never here. Yeah, you're basically from Bombay.
I'm a Bombay girl.
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
So now see, tell me, there's theater, there's film, the television.
Yeah.
You experienced all in a big way. Now you tell me what you enjoyed the most.
So difficult to say, but I think it would be between films and theater.
Okay.
TV... I wouldn't say, because TV in the country that we live in is not the best kind of form of self-exploration as an actor.
Okay.
It's difficult because it's limited, I feel, as a medium.
Okay.
But definitely film is wonderful, because at the end of the day, it's a very slow, painstaking process.
Yeah.
And they say, film is a director's medium, and theater is an actor's medium, and TV, I don't know which medium it's supposed to be. Producer's medium, maybe, I'm not sure
yeah, which medium it is. Yeah, well, it's a TRP-related medium, I think.
Some medium, advertisers. I think maybe
there,
advertisers' medium.
Advertisers, not TRP, sure whatever
that.
Works, that's what it's
that's
all about.
Like
it's
that,
got,
yeah.
Okay, right.
So, but in film, so it's apparently a director's medium, but I think, the power you get when you're emoting in front of a camera, where you're actually not doing much, but you're just able to be yourself and just think and not really. I think it's so great to be, in that small, minuscule, nano space.
Uh-huh. So it's like in front of the camera or behind the camera. That's what you're trying to say, that you've acted and directed great projects.
I've actually done both.
But what has been most fulfilling for you is what you're trying to tell me, right?
Oh, acha.
That's what I want to know.
Then as a director.
Because you're in front.
Then
and
as a director behind the camera, for sure.
Yeah?
Sure. No question. Yeah.
Really? Mm. And you're planning to direct more projects?
I'm really planning to. Yeah, I really want to, because I loved doing it. I loved being... I think I'm a bit of a control freak, like most of us are. And I loved just being in control and in charge, and then having to be able to be, and the architect of a whole lot of stuff that's going on, and having to be, in control of all that, in charge of all that, and making all the decisions.
Actually, you do the same decision-making at home where Mahesh and the kids are concerned?
Not anymore. Nobody listens to me anymore. What will I do? Pehle to karti thi thoda.
Haan, ab to bacche bhi nahi sunte.
Once in a while, Mahesh raises his voice and says, "What? Nobody's listening to me." Screams and yells a bit.
So you add your turn.
Everybody
okay?
listens.
But tell me one thing. Then, how did you meet Mahesh? How did you and Mahesh meet and then eventually get married?
It's another big long story.
Sony is a story because most people don't know. We just know that okay, Sony is married to Mahesh. She's got two beautiful daughters, and that's about it.
So one day I came back from England. I came back from England. Means that after living in Bombay, being brought up in Bombay, I did my schooling here. I went to the UK to study drama.
Okay.
Which is another story.
Okay.
Which you can read about in my blog. It's very interesting.
Okay,
life is full of stories, actually.
Ah.
Yeah. Those struggling days were very interesting.
Uh-huh.
When I came back, I was fumbling around, figuring out what to do, struggling actually as an actor. And I get a call from a good friend, Dilip Tahil.
Okay.
One Sunday morning, and the phone rings, and he said, "Hi, Sony, Dilip here." I said, "Hi, Dilip, what's up?" and all that. He said, "Today is the day." These are his words.
Really?
Today is the day. He had no clue. He didn't mean anything of the sort.
As
what finally later on happened. He had no idea, but he said, "Today is the day." I said, "Oh, what day?" He said, "We're going. I've got this friend of mine. Have you heard of Mahesh Bhatt?" I had not heard of Mahesh Bhatt. I mean, I think I'd read about him in some filmy magazine and all
right.
that. But I didn't know much about him. I didn't know what he looked like.
Huh.
I said, "No, I think I've heard about him. I don't know much about him." He said, yeah. So he's a good friend of mine. So we're going to his house. He's casting for a film. Okay. Just let's go and meet him. I said, okay. Huh. Dilip was very smart. Mahesh was working on a film. He had finished shooting Arth, and for the same producer, a script written by Vijay Tendulkar called something. I don't remember in those days what it was called. It had Mark Zubair and Dipti Nawal in it, and it needed another couple.
Okay.
So Dilip had come, was wanting to pitch himself as another couple and me as his wife.
Right.
And it was, you know, all about marital discord and things like that. Very interesting, but not as dramatic as Arth.
Okay.
But it was about a guy who goes to, with some friends, to Goa and then falls in love with a tribal woman.
All right.
That, something like
the
that.
Story, okay.
Something vague like that. I can't remember very clearly. But anyway, it was so we went and met Mahesh. And yeah, that's how I met him. I went into his house for work.
But you just met him and then what?
Then nothing happened. Then I got the role. I got the role and then we went to shoot in Goa. And I suppose then, you know, attraction
there was.
Started. Yeah, but it
I, mean,
like,
immediately,
I was
talking
an
about
actor,
the first...
he was a director. And we were going for, I was going for work, yeah. So I was more worried about my work than about anything else. So attraction can happen and not happen. That's a part of life, you know.
I know.
Never thought it would translate into marriage. So that was interesting.
Okay, now tell me, Mahesh was already married. So did you feel at any moment that, okay, we want to be with each other and maybe we cannot? Did that ever happen?
Of course.
It did.
I mean, it was not a it was not even a consideration for me because he was married. So I was like, I'm attracted to his person, but that's okay. I mean, I can be attracted. I don't.
Right.
Yeah, I don't have to be
necessarily
you know,
married.
Yeah, nothing has to go from. Nothing has to come out of it. Also.
Absolutely.
Not even a relationship. So it took us many months before we actually had a relationship. It didn't happen. It wasn't instant or anything like that.
Okay.
Yeah, simply because of this reason. And, yeah, I went to... I didn't think that it would ever happen like that. Because I... In my mind, I had never thought perhaps I would marry somebody who was already, you know, was married and whatever. But then things start evolving and you know how
and
it is.
And you kind of decided, yes, we have to be with each other.
Well, we fell in love and then one thing led to another.
Yeah.
But then also, you know, he also said that I don't want to, you know, reach the age of 85 and realize that I have not done something. So I'd let you go.
Sonny, this happens in so many cases. No, but I really agree. I was talking the other day about a certain person who's in love with this actress we all know for many, many years. And I said, I just wish the last 5 years of his life, he would turn around and tell her, look, I want to be with you.
Yeah.
Because you just let life, you live for your children, you live for your family, you live for your neighbors, uncle, aunts. But you hardly ever get to live for yourself. You're constantly living your life to please others.
Yeah.
So I said, one should just get up and say, okay, this is what I want to do.
And at some point in your life, these are milestones in your life.
Yeah.
When you realize that, you know, this is what is important to me. This is not important to me. This has to be dealt with. This has to be left aside. I have to shed this.
No,
I have to go there. So you have to, I think you have to come to those points in your life and recognize them. Otherwise, you know, you get so sort of bogged down by life itself.
And you have to be able to take a chance. Most people cannot. Most people live their lives. Go by and they go away and they still haven't been able to make that decision of what they want.
But isn't it getting more and more easier now to do that?
It's getting easier.
In my day, it was so difficult.
I agree. That's what I'm talking about then.
Like
today, it's still easier. But you know, again, you're talking about the other generation. Our generation till today also cannot do such things. Their decisions are still based on what he'll think and what they'll want and what they'll do, even today.
But I hear the divorce rate is... Because a lot of women are getting divorced earlier where they're not taking stuff that... that they were willing to take earlier because perhaps they're financially independent and...
Yeah, today that's
that
where they're
of course is in metros, not everywhere else.
I agree, but chalo. Tell me one thing. Now, you married Mahesh. You've got gossip, death threats and the paparazzi. Now, how do you deal with this entire, how does the family deal with all this? Because it's just been at you from every corner.
I don't know.
Yeah, because Sony, not everybody can...
I don't know how
can...
we deal with it. I don't even actually know how we deal with it. I don't think about it.
Yeah, but
I think that's the way I deal with it. I don't actually go looking for the gossip. Or I don't
agree.
Actually go looking for the death threats either, which thankfully they're not there now.
And the paparazzi just lands up.
Paparazzi, I think we all love each other.
We all love each other.
Yeah, we have to kind of like live with
how has WhatsApp taken all this? How do the kids deal with all this?
With what?
With just what I said, whether it's the paparazzi, the cholo, I can understand now. With all this gossip and death threats, like I said, it's a little tough on the kids, isn't it?
At that time it was.
At
that time it was very scary.
Yeah.
Very, very scary.
But now all over and gotten with it.
I don't know. We just have to.
You just live one. Okay. Yeah, yeah. Now I recently read that you had a very uncomfortable Me Too moment.
Hmm.
I just read about very recently.
Hmm.
So tell me exactly when and what was this that you decided to talk about it now?
Oh gosh. So the first place I had actually even forgotten that I had a Me Too moment.
Huh.
Till somebody asked me the question. Huh. I mean, it hadn't even come into my. I mean, honestly, I think Anu, my life is so crazy.
Huh.
There's so much happening and going on. So all this was going on, and I'm like, oh gosh, how brave Avinta, how wonderful ye wo. I didn't think of myself at all. I forgot. कि मेरे मेरे साथ भी ऐसा कुछ हुआ था एक 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 टाइम
इट मस्ट हैव गॉन राइट देयर द बैक ऑफ द माइंड
आई फॉरगॉट आई फॉरगॉट एंड आई वाज डूइंग एन इंटरव्यू फॉर माय बर्थडे एंड यू नो द लेडी आस्क्ड मी दिस क्वेश्चन एंड सडनली रिमेंबर्ड इट राइट देयर सो आई आल्सो थॉट आई डिडंट सेंसर माय सेल्फ आई सेड व्हाई शुड आई लाई व्हाई शुड आई प्रिटेंड व्हाई शुड आई Somebody has asked me a question, I'll tell the truth. So I said, I remember it. I said, oh yeah, exactly, I remember. Ye hua tha mere saath.
Right.
And this was the reason I did this. This is the reason I didn't do that. That was it.
That's what I'm saying. A lot of time, I think most people who we talk to, Sony, have had this experience. Most everyone we know.
Yeah.
But it's gone at the back of the head. Because
totally.
They realize at that time, nothing could be done about it. Talking about it won't help. Nothing.
It was water under the bridge for me. It's gone. That river has flown far away. I mean,
but tell me one thing. Now, right now, you think the media is playing a fair role in this movement? I mean, aren't they? They're more of a political agenda than actually what there is. Because all of a sudden, it's just died down. There was this huge thing, and then every day you hear name Iskand, and they say no, he's too powerful. They can't talk. Then you hear about another person. Oh, this one has paid off so and so person. Daily, you know, and you know there has to be some truth. Why not 100? Why only these 10 guys? It's just died a natural
Well,
death.
I mean, I think that's in a way very typical of media attention. When it is only going to remain media attention. The fact of the matter is, if it's a Me Too movement, it can't stop with media attention. It has to go beyond media attention. And I think that is the only criticism I think probably the Me Too movement has received from women themselves,
huh.
Is that if you're going to have a Me Too movement, because huh. I've put a little bit of thought behind this,
huh.
Ki about this Me Too movement, what are the good things about it? What are the not so good things about it?
Huh.
Okay, and we are not supposed to say anything not good about it. It's supposed to
right.
be fantastic.
Right.
I agree it is.
Right.
But I think until and unless you do not take this many, many steps further,
huh.
It can't end with media attention.
No.
It has to be taken into an arena whereby women who don't have media attention, who are not privileged enough to get it.
But Sony,
what about all these women who don't have... Who are nobody? Who nobody knows?
No, that's
them.
What I'm saying. How is anybody going to hear about it? The media is all of a sudden who blasted this out of control. Now, there is not a word.
But tell
because
me something.
They feel only if somebody known comes up,
exactly.
they talk about it.
Exactly.
Which is not fair because
exactly.
it's happening everywhere.
But, so therefore, now, why are we going to open bureaus and call women and say, how are we going to do it? Or are we going to open places where women can go and give their, get help actually. So I think that is what the government needs to do. It's and NGOs need to do. It is not about the media. The media has perhaps taken what they could and now they need to. It's not up to the media. I feel it's up to us as individuals to take it forward as a movement.
But Sony, you think anything can happen like this? Everyone talks about
it. I think it can. But I think it now requires a lot of will to do that. And who is going to do it? As an individual, you can talk about your problem. But who is going to actually say, from the government is going to come forward and say, okay, let's open a center for women who, if they have been raped, can go to, physically go to and give have protection, shelter there. And there is maybe perhaps police officers there who will, you will give, where, those halfway houses, what you
understood,
call.
Understood.
So who is going to do this? I would say that this is what needs to be done. It can't be a Me Too movement, cannot begin and end with media attention and somebody very rightly and justly are offloading their pain and their angst. But once they have done that, where does it go from there?
So
I think that's what we need to.
That's what you need, individuals to come forward
yes,
and help. There is nobody coming forward. And why I said media is because the fact is, the minute they hear a few names who are people of power or in position, it becomes news for them. Every day you hear people talking about it. Nobody gives a damn. Nobody gives a damn. And everyone I talk to, they said, it's already died. Can't you do something? What can you do about it? You can't
there
do.
Things that can
but
be.
There are individuals who have to be
there
and become
things,
a voice.
It has to be. It has to be people driven. Any movement, any recourse to any kind of justice has to be people driven. And we have to take this movement beyond the cities, beyond well known
yeah,
personalities.
Yeah, yeah.
We have to take it to the places where it really matters. And right. where no, I'm not saying this doesn't really matter.
Yeah, yeah,
I'm
yeah.
saying we have to take it to the places where it matters because those women don't have a voice.
They don't have a
we
voice.
Have to take it to those places. So how we do that, I think, is the next step.
Yeah.
Let us understand that it can't begin and end with this. It has begun. It has to now go on.
Yeah.
And how do we do that is now a question which we need to all ask ourselves and figure out the answer.
Yeah, so we're going to get someone to, obviously, one has to start pushing this and talk about
absolutely.
It. Now to something a little lighter. You have one daughter, Alia.
Mm-hmm.
Alia is... Tell us about Alia the daughter and about Alia the superstar. Now, what is there? Because Alia is now a household name. Hmm. She's doing brilliantly in her field, in her career. And you being mama of Alia, tell me, how do you handle the superstar Alia and the baby Alia?
I think the baby Alia for me was a phase which I think went away too fast out of my life, at least. I don't know about hers. But she kind of stopped being baby Alia very, very soon. And so I was very grateful for those few years I had between her, you know, being still, you know, this young Alia and then the one that who just became old enough and, able to then afford her own space where she then bought a flat and moved out of home. So those few years in between, apart from the fact that when you're a child, you're a child and you're,
right.
you know, there's a different relationship altogether. But I really cherished those few years where, you know, I was running after her. She was still in the house. And I'm like, you know, have tea with me for 5 minutes every morning.
Yeah.
We just sit
yeah.
that little time. But I think what is nice about our relationship now today is that when we meet, it might be just for half an hour. We're having, come for tea, come for lunch, come for dinner, whatever it is. I go to her place, she comes to my place. We are so blessed, Anu, that we live so close together.
I know.
You know, it's just almost, and anyway, even if she was living at home today, I'd never see her.
Yeah, yeah,
so
yeah.
then I think perhaps this is better, that I get
when she's there,
hour,
she's with
consolidated
you.
Half an hour
yeah,
with her.
Yeah.
And that's wonderful. And sometimes I don't even tell my husband I'm going to meet her because if he comes, you know, then the attention goes to him.
Uh-huh.
So I, so yeah, being father and all that, so he has a way of getting attention onto himself very effortlessly.
Yeah, from
so,
all you guys.
Yeah, so then I sneak into her house without anybody else knowing. So I get half an hour with her so I can chat with her, talk to her. Or once in a very blue moon we go out for lunch or for dinner.
I know.
And those
I
are
know.
Nice. Those are nice moments. Recently we also went, you know.
I know,
and
Mama's
your daughter.
Day.
Yeah.
Actually, but tell me one thing, Soni. Hmm. How did, when did Alia first come and tell you, okay, Mom, I've got this film? Because see, that first time, how did you react? Was it always on your mind? How is it that that first time that, okay, guys, guess what? I think Alia's on her way out. From home and into the
I
bigger
space.
I
remember two moments very clearly. One was when, she was, when we met Karan and he sort of liked her audition, he said, I really like her, but she has to lose some weight. So 3 months she had. Before the photo shoot. So this
right.
was what, September, end of September or whatever.
She was in school, I think, finishing 11th, 12th. Or...
She was still in school.
Yeah,
but she had, I think this was September.
Right.
September, October, November we had. And the photo shoot was going to be in December. The clinching photo shoot or whatever.
Okay.
I think he was going to make a decision or whatever.
Uh-huh.
So she had to lose the weight in those 3 months, which was a task. Because it's
poor
not...
Thing.
Yeah, she was, you know, from eating chips and having cold coffee.
Eating fine burgers
we
in
went
the cupboards.
We went straight to only egg and tomato for breakfast, only chicken and salad for lunch, only something else for dinner, and no carbs. And then she was like, after about 1 month of that, her hair started falling out. And like, I called up the nutritionist. I said, you know, we need some oats. We need some roti. We need some dal roti. So 3 times a week we're out dal roti. You know, we went a little bit. We added because we were going a little hysterical over that. She was of course hysterical. Yeah? too much. Yeah. But anyway, it happened. She lost 13, 14 kilos, whatever it is.
Oh, poor baby.
It just changed completely. And we did the photo shoot. And after the photo shoot, Karan came up to me. She was not there. She was still inside or whatever. Karan came up to me and said, I just want to tell you that I've decided to take her. And I said, and I'm going to direct the film. Because at that, till that point, he was not planning to direct Student of the Year.
Okay.
Somebody else was directing it. You know, he hadn't found the director yet. I was so happy.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, so we were in the car. And then I think we went and had...
A burger.
No, we went and had macaroons or something. I said, Alia, you deserve this now. Let's eat cake. Let's have cake because for 3 months you're not anything sweet.
Oh.
So we had cake. So I was so excited. And then I remember the first day of shoot when we were, I was on the way. And I tweeted. I tweeted something to the effect of, I have to find the tweet if it still exists. I don't know.
It'll be there.
You know, that baby's on her way to claim her destiny.
How nice. She's done such a good job.
Yeah.
Oh, how sweet.
Yeah. So that was like very emotional moment for me because I kind of felt that she was going into that, into her life.
Yeah.
You know, she was, we were driving towards her life.
Yeah,
yeah.
I know, I've seen her like since birth, I think. Little baby that then losing all that weight. I remember Kanchi, Sonia, to open her cupboard. I used to smell food. I said, what is this? She's too hard. Burgers is too hard. They said, Mama saying, don't become fat. So in that cupboard, there were burgers sitting and eating.
Yeah,
so, but poor thing, all of a sudden, no food at all. It's a tough one.
It's tough.
But chalo, good for Alia to imbrindle. He's so happy for her. Now tell me about Shaheen.
Yes.
Shaheen is an upcoming author.
Yes.
And she's just written her first book.
Yes.
Which is being read and is doing brilliantly in the space that people are reading it, buying it, and talking about it.
Yeah.
What is your feeling on that?
Well, obviously, I'm so happy for Shaheen because I have seen her struggles for so many years to find out, to find her voice, to find a place in the sun, to find her desk. Not even, just to find to find her groove, I would say. And as we all know from after you sort of know what the book is all about, it is about her battle with depression, which again is a very important topic.
Yes.
So it's actually about, the book is about a struggle of a person to come to terms or even discover the fact that you have depression in the first place, or maybe you are depressed at that moment, or whatever it is. It's a very, nobody is born with depression.
Right.
And it kind of happens to you. And then you have to even understand that it's happening to you. So I think that is...
Most of us don't.
Yeah, nobody does. I mean, very few people do.
Right.
And it takes a lot of kind of sort of a little bit of distance from yourself to kind of figure out that perhaps this is what I have and this is what I need to address.
You all knew about it in the family? You knew what she was going through?
We didn't know until we also come to, it's a journey of a family actually.
And you thought she was just behaving in a particular manner?
I didn't know. I didn't understand. I didn't understand what was wrong.
Okay.
Because she was fine. She seemed to be fine. She covered it up very well.
Right.
And so until and unless I could not figure out, and she was going to college, she was doing everything.
Normal.
Maybe not getting up in the morning, because the reason why she couldn't get up in the morning was because she didn't sleep all night.
Yeah.
So that was a big problem. And how to then first address, we were addressing insomnia. We thought, ka insomnia hai.
Right.
So insomnia was the big problem. And then me being a very sort of, I'm a doer. I'm a practical person as well as being very emotional, but I'm a very practical person. So my thing is, Shaheen, if you work during the day, then you'll sleep well during the night. Tumhara cycle gadbad hai. Probably a lot of contributing factors to depression is the fact that you're awake till 3 a.m. on the phone, on the tablet, on the this, on the that. We don't realize how much this is actually affecting our hormones or all kinds of things. So somewhere I think it's all connected. But not being a professional psychiatrist, I can't go and give my gyan about that. I knew from my side, is my perspective, is my daughter was not able to sleep. And then when we finally did understand, when we went to get some medical help, they discovered that perhaps her problem is not just insomnia. It's related to other issues. And therefore, then we started delving into all that. So I was always this positive person. Like, hum theek karenge.
But the reason is now found out, so you know where to
get
it.
Well, definitely she's... Today, as we speak, she now is living in London as a student. She's studying interior design.
Right.
She's also writing... more of her book because this is an e-book.
Yeah.
And they want to come out with a paperback version. So that means she has to write more words. So all these things are happening to her and she is now in control of her life.
Right. So that
which
makes
is so wonderful. Yeah.
I'll tell you a small thing. Anushka, that's my elder daughter. Anushka used to get up every morning crying.
Hmm.
Every morning she was depressed. What happened? I couldn't sleep and she's crying away. Now, we obviously had no clue. Then they went, remember you, Shaheen Alia, went to Viva Maya? She and Kanchi went to Viva Maya. And then she found out, the doctors did all the various tests. Mm. And she said, I can't sleep. And when I get up in the morning, I'm always crying. Mm. And I have no reason for crying.
Mm.
Apparently, what happened with her was there's something called a happy hormone. I don't know about this.
Serotonin.
So I'm talking about it. They told her that, what do you eat in the night? It somehow came that she eats fruit. They said that sweetness or that fruit, something of it, is what doesn't suit you. Because of that, you get up depressed. So cut that out of your life. And that was sorted.
Are you serious?
I'm very serious. So I was like freaked out. I said, why? And every morning crying. And she was like, I'm depressed. I don't know why.
So that hormone was not kicking
in. That hormone was what was wrong.
Because it has to come. It has
to. Right. So sometimes I'm saying
All of it is actually
some
an imbalance. There's an imbalance.
Yeah.
Or there's a link in the brain which is, not connecting.
Yeah.
So how the doc explained it to Shaheen that, your some synapses or something like that, they're not working as they should.
Right.
There's been some damage to that.
Right.
We don't even know the reasons.
They don't know the reasons.
But they know how to address it. And it's a process. So you take a bit of medication, then it doesn't suit you or it suits you or you take something else. So now finally she's found something which actually is working for her really well.
See, once you find out what it is, it starts working.
And it's
properly.
Not necessary that she has to be on it lifelong or anything. She has to just get things. I think the body has to come back into balance or the brain has to come into balance or something has to balance. And then, and you know how it is, hormones keep changing.
Yeah,
I know for myself, I don't have a problem of depression, but when I was younger, I used to have a lot of hormonal
issues,
ups and downs,
which
now are not there. Yeah. And I feel
so
like I'm a different person.
I actually feel,
how was I this hysterical, screeching person or crying person or whatever person? I was I feel so relieved that today.
But
I've understood that it's hormonal.
Yeah, yeah. It's
and
all
I didn't seem to have control at that time over my anger, over my emotions, over what I used to do. And I was completely hormone driven, and we all are.
And we have no clue.
But we actually don't realize that
it's like when Deepika went and said, I'm depression. I remember talking to how many people. They said, she has everything. Why is she depressed?
Exactly.
So it's got nothing to do with what you have, everything.
Not
it's
at
something
all.
Totally different.
And it can be that horrible vacuum in your system. You have all these pressures to perform, to do this, to do that. But actually, all you want to do is lie in your bed with a cover over your head.
And don't get out.
Yeah, you don't get out.
I go through this so many times. Yeah. I say, I just don't want to get out. I don't want to see the world.
Yeah.
I don't want to face anyone.
Yeah.
And then you feel, okay, theek hai.
No, there are times in our lives when all of us as human beings,
there's
been a trigger. We've got into depression. Okay,
your
relationship didn't work out. Maybe your... So I went through one of these where I was for 6 months depressed. Not in the same way as perhaps, but I had the same feeling. So I completely understand it. I didn't want to get out of bed in the morning, but I used to force myself.
Yeah.
Then I would be sitting in a car and tears would be just streaming down my face.
Yeah, you're right.
I mean, hello, what was going on? I was in a zone where I had no control over what my body was feeling.
Right.
It was just dictating to me that this is how you are feeling. And because I have been so-called normal for the bulk of my life, I could recognize
that this
period of time, I'm going through this. I knew what the trigger was and I was able to get out of it. One day I woke up and I'm like, the sun is shining. The sky is blue. Oh God, I feel so relieved. I'm no longer in that dark place.
Yeah.
But I can completely understand anybody who is going through that.
A lot of kids today go through
absolutely.
This.
Absolutely. And
like
I can completely understand that it's not in your control.
Yeah.
So don't feel that... just don't feel it is going to change. It can change.
And you have to talk about
help.
It.
But get help.
Yeah, you have to talk about it.
For God's sakes, get help.
Everything that happens, if you talk about it, half your problems are sorted.
Firstly. Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Anyway, thank you. And Sony, now I'll come back to my IT awards, which are happening next month, guys. 10th of December, IT awards. Sony's been there from year one. I just wanted to tell me something about IT and your relationship with awards and talent and how important are they in... The business of, I think in every field, but in entertainment, is to be honored and recognized for what you do.
Yes. Well, I mean, you know better than anybody else how we used to go to these film award functions.
Because I'm telling you guys, I started ITA, why I brought this up. Thanks to Sony. We were walking on the beach one day, many, many years ago, now 20 years ago, Sony, Nina and me. We went to a film award which was treating us like shit. And
well, you used to have half an hour for television awards.
And fits quickly.
And
then she told me, Kanu, why don't you start TV awards? I said, I don't know if I can. She said, if anyone can, you can. And that is how television's ITA started.
Yeah.
So thanks to Sony, ITA is... Now tell me, how do you feel about ITA?
I feel so happy that you're doing it and the way you're doing it, because I feel... I mean, as I said, you were the one who could make a success of it. It wasn't really up my street at all, and I would never have wanted to do it. But I'm so glad that Anu took it up, and you know, you did it, because today it's such a big, it's a big award sort of space,
right,
which deserves every place that it has, you know, in the scheme of things.
Thank you so much, and that is Sony ki wajah se I'm here talking about ITA, guys.
No, great. So and congratulations, firstly, and secondly, yeah, I can't say this enough. I think you need your validation, and I don't believe in the fact that okay, yes, of course, the audience gives you your award and reward and whatever it is, but it is so nice when you get on stage and you get that, you know, get that recognition from an outside body.
Right,
and you're in I would say not competition, but everybody is there, you know, and then you get that recognition because you have done the best in that space. I think it's so important to get that validation, so important.
Yeah, really. And why, Sony? I feel Indian, besides the Emmys in America, India is the only country which has so many programming, so much done in house.
Right.
So I feel we're the second largest TV country in the world. And today we've got web, so it's an important thing, you know,
absolutely,
to be able to recognize amongst all those people that you're the one who's done the best.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yes. So that was it, guys. Anything else from Sony? You send us your messages. We're going to answer them soon. And we're going to be seeing you soon. Anything else, Sony, you'd like to say before we sign off and say bye-bye, Tata?
Thank you. It's been wonderful talking to you.
So sweet.
And
yes.
Great fun. So I hope you guys enjoy the show.
Thank you. And see you episode 6 a week from now. Bye-bye. See ya.